Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins, which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. And 5 of them were wise, and 5 were foolish. They that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. While the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. Verse 6. And at midnight there was a cry made, behold, the bridegroom cometh. Go ye out to meet him. Now I'm sure that any of you who have been in church for any length of time know the story of the 10 virgins.
Amen.
Amen.
But there may be some people in here who have not yet heard this story or have not come to an understanding of what this story is all about. So that with that in mind, I need to identify the players that we hear mentioned in this text. The bridegroom in the text is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Thank you, Father. Thank you.
Amen.
Amen.
The wedding feast is the wedding feast of the Lamb, or the marriage supper of the Lamb, or the Church of Christ, the true Church of Christ will be gathered to meet the Lord in the air, and they will have this reunion like we cannot even imagine. That's what the wedding is all about.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Some people refer them as maids of honor, but God calls them the virgins. The 10 virgins represent religious people in this world. People of all different religions. Amen?
Amen.
And the oil in the lamp represents the Holy Spirit, the righteousness of God. Amen?
Amen.
So we got all the players together, right? As this text opens, God says that there are 10 virgins. Now, the first thing that came to my mind was, why did God refer to them as virgins? I could think of all kind of terminologies or descriptions that I would have used, but I never would have thought of using the word virgin. God says that there was 10 of them. So then the question that has to come to your mind is, what is a virgin? Now, most of us in here, the first thought that would come to our mind would mean that it was someone who was not sexually active. Amen? But I want you to understand that the word virgin is also used in other ways. Virgin oil, when you're cooking. Amen? Virgin territory that has not yet been explored. Right? So when I looked at all of these definitions of the word virgin, I came up with the fact that it means being in a pure state.
Amen.
Something that is uncultivated or unexplored for someone else's use. Okay? Now then the question comes to my mind, well, why did God refer to all 10 as virgins? Because he said 5 were wise, right?
Yes.
And 5 were foolish. So if it was me, I would have said the 5 wise were virgins, and I would have said the 5 foolish were not. But God refers to all 10,
right?
As virgins. Which means that all 10 have a sense of holiness and purity within their lives.
Right.
Now remember, I already told you that the 10 virgins symbolized people who are religious. People who make a profession of knowing God and wanting to serve God. Now their God can be called Allah, their God can be called Yahweh, their God can be called Buddha, their God can be called whatever God they name they choose to call their God. So they are considered religious people. And notice that God refers to these people that are religious people that are supposed to believe in God as people that are holy, people who have set themselves aside to serve God. Now that's the way God looks at it when he looks at us as it looks at those who say that we are followers of him and believers and all this other kind of stuff, that he expects us now to live lives that are not involved with anything that would cause us to become defiled or unclean.
Amen.
That's a whole different story. Okay? So anyway, you got the players. You understand that all 10 virgins are considered people who are believe in God and people who are saying that they have separated themselves, that they're now living a holy life consecrated to God. But I want you to notice that God says in this text that there was 5 wise and 5 foolish. So what we're going to do is we're going to examine this text and we're going to see what we can learn from this text that we can apply to us to help us to understand why he called 5 of them foolish. Amen? The first reason that he called 5 of them foolish can be found right inside of the scripture. God said they were foolish because they had no oil with them. The oil signifies what?
The Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit. So God said they're foolish because they are making a profession of believing in God, but they're not coming to God in the right way.
Amen.
You have to understand, my brothers and sisters in Christ, everybody, even the devil, says he believes in God. But everybody that believes in God is not going to make their way into heaven. I want you to understand, my brothers and sisters in Christ, that the first prerequisite for these virgins in order to be considered wise is the fact that they had to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Well, you cannot be filled with the Holy Spirit until you have repented of your sins and asked Jesus to come into your heart and to save you. So what they were doing was they were trying to be right with God in their own strength.
Amen.
They were trying to be right with God by obeying a certain set of rules and regulations of doing this and doing that and doing the other. They were basing their relationship with God on what they did and not on what Christ did.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, it is so important for you all to understand what I'm saying and to get what I'm saying, because God said, yes, they were all virgins. They were all religious people. They were all people who were making a profession of believing in God. But God said that of those 10 who made the profession of believing in God, only 5 were right and the other 5 were wrong.
Amen.
Do you understand that? Because they were trying to be right with God by what they did rather than what Christ had done for them at Calvary. So my brothers and sisters in Christ, there's 3 things that I believe that these women did, and God used women only as an example, no particular reason, amen, but
amen,
mostly because he wanted to use the word virgin, amen, and we normally apply that to the female sex, amen.
Amen.
But God wants you to understand there's 3 things that those 5 unwise virgins did not do. And God says he wants to make sure this morning that you don't do the same thing that they did. So I need you to turn in your Bibles to 2 Corinthians, the 13th chapter, the 8th verse. All of them believed in God. You go go out on the street, you ask people, do you believe in God? 9 out of 10 people you meet are going to say, yes, I believe in God. Right?
Yes.
But I want you to understand that believing in God with your in your natural mind, in your natural state, that is not going to do you a hill of beans worth of good. You can believe in God and bust hell wide open.
Amen.
Do you understand that?
Yes.
2 Corinthians 13:8. What did these virgins do or not do that God can call them unwise? 2 Corinthians 13:8 says, examine yourself to see whether you are in the faith. Test yourself. Do you not realize that Christ Jesus is in you unless, of course, you fail the test? What they did not do, and what each one of you in here this morning has got to do, you've got to examine yourself. I've not noticed this text did not say that you had to examine the person sitting next to you. That you got to examine your mother, your father, your sister, your brother. But you've got to examine yourself. Test yourself to see if you really have Jesus living inside of your heart as Lord and Savior.
Amen.
God said, test yourself. Prove yourself. These five virgins were depending on themselves and on what they were doing. They were not examining themselves. They were not examining the word to see if what they were doing was going along with what the word said. They were basing their relationship with God on tradition, on what someone else had told them, rather than checking it out for themselves. They didn't examine. It says, examine yourself. Don't you know that Christ Jesus lives inside of you? Of course, unless when you examine yourself and test yourself, you find out he's not there after all. When you examine yourself and test yourself and look at how you're living and the things that you're doing, you're going to come to the conclusion, if you're honest with yourself, whether Jesus is there or he is not there. Remember, God had referred to all of these women as virgins, as being pure and all this holy and all this other kind of stuff. But being pure and holiness in yourself is not going to cut it. Don't you understand? Being pure and holy in yourself will not do it. If you do not have the purity and the holiness of Christ imputed on you because you have repented of your sins and God made an exchange in your life where he took your sin and gave you his righteousness. Check yourself out. Check yourself out. Are you wise or are you foolish? A foolish person refuses to look at themselves. You know what else made them unwise? Turn to Proverbs 28:26. This is one that is, all of them are good. But what else made them unwise? What else caused them that when the bridegroom came, and they stood at the door and knocked on the door and said, let us in, the bridegroom said, get away from me, I never knew you.
Amen.
But they were still virgins. Do you understand? They still had that outward appearance of purity and holiness and all of that other kind of stuff. But the outward appearance never made it to the inside.
Amen.
The outward appearance never made it to the inside. You can dress in white like I'm dressed now. I can have my dress down to my knee. I've said this a million times before. It's not what's on the outside that makes you holy. It's what is on the inside. God said, examine yourself, first of all. Proverbs 28:26. When you have, speak to me, Lord.
Speak to me, Lord.
He who trusts in himself is a what?
Fool.
He who trusts in himself is a fool. He who trusts in himself is a fool. But God says, if we trust in ourselves, we're a fool.
Amen.
You say, wait a minute, Pastor, I don't understand that. Because don't you teach your children to trust themselves and have pride in themselves and believe in themselves and all? Don't we do that?
Yeah.
Don't we teach our kids that they got to have pride in themselves and they got to trust themselves and believe in themselves? But God is saying, when you trust in yourself apart from trusting in God, that's when you become a fool.
Amen.
When you trust in yourself to be able to do this, that, and the other without saying, because of God, or with the help of God, or through
Amen.
The grace of God, I'm going to do this, that, and the other. When you take the credit for everything you do on
Amen.
Yourself,
Amen.
God said you are a natural born fool. Now, you know, and I hate to use that word because God tells us in his word that we're not to call each other fools. Don't he tell us that? That's what he said. But he didn't say anything about him calling us fools. So when I say this, don't get mad at me, because I didn't write it. But God said, if you trust in yourself to be right with God, by coming to church on Sunday, by singing on the choir, by coming to Bible study, all the wonderful things that I want you to do all the time, if you think that makes you right with God, you're wrong.
Amen.
It doesn't make you. The reason that you want to do these things is so that you'll grow stronger in the Lord and you can examine yourself and you can see more of Jesus inside of you, but nothing that you can do will ever warrant you being able to make it into heaven.
Amen.
I've told you this since I've been here. I've been here for 13 years and I've told you, if you could have made your way to heaven by yourself, Jesus never would have had to die.
Amen.
So if you trust in yourself, well, I'm a good person. I get so tired of hearing people tell me that. I'm a good person. I don't do this. I don't try to hurt my neighbor, and I don't try. Honey, your goodness don't mean nothing.
Amen.
You got to get to the place where you're like John. I think it was John the Baptist or Paul when he says, "When you look at me, you don't see me. I want you to see the Christ that's in me."
Amen.
I want the goodness that you think that I have. I want the whatever that you think that I have, that you don't give the glory and the praise to me, but you give the glory and the praise to the one that we serve.
Amen.
Five of these virgins were wise, but five of them were foolish. And they all started off in the same place.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, I want you to understand something before I take you to the next scripture. I want you to understand, I think it's two or three words that said, while the bridegroom tarried, while the bridegroom waited, while the bridegroom hadn't come, it said they all slumbered and slept. Right? Didn't
yeah.
it say that?
Yeah.
So that means the wise slept,
and the unwise.
And so did the unwise sleep.
Amen.
So what does that mean? First of all, when it says the bridegroom tarried, that means that was God's divine delay.
Mm-hmm.
His divine delay. Now, I don't know about you, but I know all of you have experienced God's divine delay in your life. Where you have prayed and asked him for something, and it seemed like it was never going to be answered, and all this other kind of stuff, and you done begged, and you done pleaded, and you done struck bargains with him, and all this other, is God's divine delay. But what you got to understand is during God's divine delay, you got to be preparing yourself for when he comes.
Amen.
Amen. For the answer of whatever it is that you prayed for.
Amen.
God said, I'm not going to give you the answer of what you prayed for because you're not prepared for it.
Amen.
Is that what he said?
Thank you, Father.
While the bridegroom tarried, the divine delay, during the divine delay, what do? We grumble, complain, we do this, we do that, the other, instead of preparing ourselves for the answers. You want a husband. I know a girl used to work with me and so scared. Matter of fact, it was Frankie's on. On Betty, she wanted, she had been married and divorced and so forth. And
she wanted to get married. She wanted a husband, right? So she started praying to God for a husband. So she went to this lady who was an elderly lady, was a saint of God. And the lady said, well, if you want a husband, you need to start preparing your trousseau. And she said, preparing my trousseau? I haven't found anybody yet. She said, yeah, but what you need to do, you need to be prepared for when he comes.
That's right.
So she went and bought a whole chest, got these sexy nightgowns and put it in, and, you know, all the other kind of things and so forth. And within like 2 weeks, she had met this man. And she told me, she said, Joanne, I know that man is not the one God sent me, because he's a reformed alcoholic. And I told God I never want to have anybody near me that ever was an alcoholic. And 2 weeks later, they were married. The one that she said she reformed now, he wasn't still doing it. He was a reformed alcoholic, okay? But the thing was, she described to him exactly, to God, exactly what kind of man she wanted, okay? And God said, that's what you think you want. But I know that I got something better for you. And I want you to know that this man became a deacon in the church, and they served in the church side by side for like 30 years until she died.
Amen.
He was the best husband that she ever could have asked for.
Amen.
But when she decided to pray, God said, you got to start preparing for what you're asking me for.
Wow.
Divine delay
Amen.
Is a preparation period.
Amen.
It is time. She said she's leaving. Wait, I'm not messing with none of y'all. Let me get this sermon done. Okay, but divine delay is a time of preparation where you're to be preparing for the answer or preparing for the return of our Lord and Savior, Amen. Jesus the Christ. So the thing is, y'all have to leave. Get out of here. Get out of here. Turn to Matthew 15, verse 8. So there was a divine delay. And scripture says that they all slept, right? Which means they all went about doing their normal everyday thing. Do you understand? It wasn't that the five foolish went to sleep and the five wise stayed awoke. It wasn't. They all slept. So during the divine delay, they were going about doing their everyday things, living their life, right? But what is it that the wise, foolish versions did that was not acceptable to God? Matthew 15:8. You have it. Speak to me, Lord.
Speak to me, Lord.
This people draw near unto me with their mouth and honor me with their lips. But their heart is far from it.
Amen.
These people honor me with their, draw near to me with their mouth. Honor me with their lips. Which means they talk the talk.
But don't walk the walk.
But they don't walk the walk.
Amen.
Right? They talk the talk. They know what to say. They know when to say amen, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus, whatever. But if they would examine themselves and look for the Christ inside of them and look for the fruit of the Holy Spirit being in them,
yes.
It would bring them to their knees.
Yes, yes.
God says, don't talk about me. Live me.
Amen.
Don't talk about me. Live me. Let your witness be through your life. And not just through your lips. These girls were unwise because they didn't take the time to examine themselves, because they were trusting in themselves, and because they were talking it, but they weren't walking it. God said to them, depart from me. I never knew you. My brothers and sisters in Christ, I'm not going to keep you long. I'm getting ready to go. I hope and I pray that God never has to say that to any of us in here.
Amen.
Where we say, Lord, Lord, open the door. Let me in. And God says, depart from me. I don't know you. How do I know all these things about these women, these five foolish virgins? Because God said, they had no oil in their life. They were making a profession of faith, but they didn't have Christ inside of them. Remember, the oil signifies the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit. That's what, with all the, any other faith that is not grounded in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, it can have you going through the motions. But Jesus said, and I have staked my life on this, and any of you in here that are believers have staked your life on the same thing, that Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man, no woman, no boy, no girl cometh to the Father except through me. There were five wise. What made the five wise wise? They had the oil. They had the Lord inside of them. It was not because they did anything great, building the universities or whatever, but they had the Holy Spirit, which signified they had Jesus living inside of them. Five were wise. Five were foolish. They were all virgins. They were all religious people. Let me tell you, you can be religious and lost.
Amen.
You can be religious and lost.
Thank you, Lord. Yes,
don't call me religious. I am not a religious person, because a religious person can believe in the sun and the moon and worship the sun and the moon. I am not religious. I am a Christian. I am not religious. I am in a relationship with Almighty God.
Amen.
I am not religious.
Amen.
I am His child.
Amen.
And I am His servant.
Amen.
You can be religious, but lost.
Amen.
Five wise, five foolish. What camp do you fall in? Let us pray. Most holy and all wise Father.
Yes, Lord.
Daddy, I thank you.
Thank you, thank you, thank you.
I thank you, I thank you, I thank you because of your anointing and of your delivering this message. Because I know so much of it is switched around from what you had me type on this paper. But Lord God, what is it, that song that they sing, I give myself away. I just yield myself to you, Lord. And I depend on you so much in doing what you want to do and saying what you want to say. Because I know what I want to say or I do won't mean a hill of beans. It's only when it's from you. So I thank you, Lord, for your message. I thank you for touching our hearts and our minds.
Thank you.
So these words will shape and govern us, that we will not be like these five virgins. We will examine ourselves to see if Christ really lives inside of us.
Yes.
We will not trust in ourselves. We will trust in you. And we will not just honor you with our mouth and our lips and our tongue, but we will honor you with our life. We love you, Lord. In the wonderful, holy, and righteous name of Jesus, our soul says amen.
Amen.
And amen. Our invitation on him.